Okay, well, let's dive in here. We are in the very end of this study of book three, the biblical principles of authority and submission. That we're on principle five, which covers weeks 9 and 10. And so let's just, for purposes of review, we'll go through them. Principle number one is that God has placed authorities in your life. Number two, God has placed authorities in your life as a practical means of discerning his will. Principle number three, God has placed authorities in your life to provide for you a canopy of protection. And then last week, we covered God has placed authorities in your life to provide for you a barometer of your submission to him. How you respond to the submission in your natural life is a great indicator of how you respond to the submission in submission to the Lord. And here, principle number five, the final one, is this. God has placed authorities in your life to provide for you an avenue of greater intimacy with him. Now, that may sound a little strange initially, but it's such a powerful truth, and for me, it may be the most important principle. It may reflect the ultimate consequence of not dealing with this issue in your life. I've, throughout the series, told you a bit about the journey that God brought me on to discovering some of these principles, and it really flowed from a very fractured relationship with my father. And I had shared with you guys the first couple of weeks, just as a young man, I was just rage-filled. And interestingly, even once I became born again, I loved the Lord with all of my heart, sincerely, and despised my father. Those things coexisted very easily inside me, and I'm just telling you, I felt no internal conflict at all. And isn't it surprising when you observe that in someone else? Someone who really loves the Lord and then has this huge gaping hole. You know what I mean? Like, really love the Lord, they just don't like different races. Or, you know what I mean? They love the Lord, but their sex life is just out of control, and they have no problem with it. It just hasn't dawned on them. You know what I mean? Which is why we got to deal graciously and gently with people. And the scripture encourages gentle rebuke, because sometimes you just don't see. You know, and sometimes the Lord is bringing you in a process whereby he's maturing you, he's bringing relationships around you, and then he'll turn the mirror around and you go, oh. But I'm just telling you, I was an enthusiastic lover of Jesus. I had been, at this point in my life, the point that I'm going to tell you about now, I had been discipled by Jack for nearly 3 years. But we could never talk about issues with my father. That was the way to shut down the conversation. I mean, I've stormed out of many a restaurant with Jack trying to discuss that issue. That was just a non-starter for me. And I had no conviction, no conflict about it. I did have things in my life that were very frustrating to me. And I had made no connection in these things, but there were just things. There were, I'm trying to be mysterious about this. I'm just trying to think of an example. Like for instance, I would get into a public setting, like in a group of people at a party or at a rehearsal or something, and I would find myself having to continually one up whoever was talking. I would behave in ways that were just kind of obnoxious, you know, and I would consistently leave those settings and be embarrassed by my behavior. And I would think, why did I act that way? Why did I respond that way? I had developed this really intense, caustic, sarcastic sense of humor. It was really cutting. And I didn't realize, I had no idea. It was a total cataract that it was just like my father. I didn't see it. I couldn't see it. It wasn't clear to me, but man, I was becoming just like him. And that's a powerful truth. You will become like the thing you hate most, which is why God has to root that bitterness out of your life. It's a magnet. It draws you to it. It wants to conform. You know, whatever gets the most of your emotional energy, you will be drawn toward. Anyway, I was away. My college career lasted 2.5 glorious months, and it's a long story, but I'd gone to Campbell University in Buies Creek, North Carolina. And Buies Creek is exactly the kind of place you're imagining when I say Buies Creek. It was a hole in a hole in a hole in the wall. And I'd gone there because I had a full tuition scholarship, a full ride, room and board and all that, and it was just too good to pass up. So I went there, and I didn't know a single soul, and my roommate chewed tobacco and spit it in a Coke jar. It was the most isolating, strangest, bizarre experience of my life, you know, because I was a very social guy. I was sort of addicted to being social and being the center of attention. I went someplace where there was no one and nothing, and I had no money at all. My mom was just, you know, she was a single mom, and she was working, and she couldn't afford to send me to college, which is why I was there on a scholarship, and my dad was disengaged, and so I had nothing at all, nothing at all. And the terms of my scholarship were such that I had to do several things on campus while I was there, so no time for a job. And anyway, it was a Christian school, at least in name, and they had, there was nothing Christian about it other than their declaration that they were Christian, and they had a chapel service on Wednesday afternoons. And I went to a chapel service. I went to all the chapel services. I visited churches, but I couldn't find a church really there. They were all super, super small and kind of crazy. And so I would go to these chapel services, and one of the chapel services, the speaker was a guy named Josh McDowell. And Josh was promoting a book at the time he had written called His Image, My Image. It was a book on how to have a godly self-image. This way predated what I talked about Sunday, the therapeutic movement. It way predated that, and his premise was a correct self-image is to view yourself as God views you. And that is absolutely true. And so the book is devoted to adopting a God-inspired self-image rather than a worldly or self-inspired self-image. And he was up there talking. He was wearing khakis. I remember it so vividly. I can see him standing there. I can see where I was sitting. It was a pivotal moment in my life. And he was talking about how our self-image is formed. It's like a mirror, and sometimes, you know, like funhouse mirrors, you look and you get a distorted image of who you are, and it can affect your relationship with the Lord. And he said something that sent me into a blind rage. He said, "Your view of your father will inevitably impact your relationship with God." And inside me, I summoned every curse word I'd ever heard and focused them on that man. To suggest, to even imply that this man could have any impact on my relationship. I had built a relationship with the Lord that was effective solely because it bypassed my dad. Now, to suggest that somehow he was in the middle of that, I remember I was gripping the seat. I wanted to run up on stage and punch this guy in his face. And I'm not a person of temper, and I'm not a violent guy. I've never been in a fight in my life. But if I could have gotten to Josh McDowell that day, I would have punched him dead in his face for what he said to me. There was no one else in the room. I didn't care that he had written a book. It didn't matter. He didn't know me. He said that to me. And I was just livid. And all I could do was hold on until the chapel service was over. And I leapt from my feet. I was three chairs in, and I jumped over the other guys. And I ran as fast as I could out the back of the building. And I ran all the way across campus. I ran past my dorm building deep into the woods. And I ran until I couldn't run anymore, and I collapsed on the ground. And for the first time that I can recall in a dozen years, I started sobbing. I told you guys the stories a few weeks ago how I had made this vow I would never cry again. And as far as I recall, I didn't until this day. And I sobbed and sobbed and didn't know why. It wasn't a pathetic, woe is me. It was an angry, I mean, I was beating the ground. I was throwing things. I was cussing. And I had no idea why. I had no idea why. When I finally pulled myself together, it was dark and I was lost in the woods. It was in Buies Creek, North Carolina. There was no light anywhere. And when I finally pulled myself together, I just started staggering back in the direction I'd come from. And I finally found my way out. And I found my way back to my dorm. And I went up and I had no idea. I still couldn't tell you what time it was. It was just late, late at night. And I went into my dorm room and I picked up the phone and I dialed 0 and I said, I'd like to place a collect call. She said, okay, to who? I said, 757-340-5337, please, it's an emergency. And she said, who should I say is calling? And I said, it's Gary. And Jack picked up the phone and she said, hello, you have a collect call from Gary Spell. Will you accept the charges? And he said, yes, Bear, what's going on? And I started sobbing and trying to describe what was going on. And I described this guy who spoke, and I wanted to punch him in his face. And at some point, I remember this so vividly. The whole thing is like it was yesterday in my mind. At some point, Jack said, Bear, stop, stop. And I stopped, and he said, this is the most expensive way to cry. I'll call you right back. So he called me back. And I said, I don't know what's happening. I think I'm losing my mind. He said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go take a shower, and I want you to sing in the shower. I want you to come back and you're going to go to bed and you're going to fall asleep and I'm going to be praying in tongues for you. You need to go to sleep. I don't want you to think anymore. I don't want you to pray anymore. I want you to go to sleep. And I went and I took a shower and I crawled in bed and I fell asleep and I was awakened at 7 in the morning with Jack at my door. And he took me by the hand, and we walked deep into the woods. And we stayed there for a couple of days, off and on. And I started to unravel this mystery of how my rebellion was hindering my relationship with the Lord. This unforgiveness, this fundamental distrust of authority was hindering my... See, I thought that taking the anger from me would cost me something. But here's the key. The Lord's objective is always greater intimacy with you. That's always his objective. I know that sometimes it feels like he's just a killjoy. Like he just doesn't want you to have fun, maybe. Or maybe that he's a control freak and he has to be in charge. But I'm just telling you, God's not egotistical like that. And he's not insecure like that. Everything he's doing to set you free so that you can come into a deeper relationship with him. I know this feels a little trite, but in those seasons, and we all have them, those seasons when you say, God, why is this happening? What are you doing? The answer is always, ultimately, so that you can know him better, so that you can be in a more intimate relationship with him. I can't tell you how many times in my brokenness I've asked the Lord, God, why is this happening? Why are you doing this? To have him respond, because you said you want to know me. Because you prayed so many times, whatever it takes, and I am honoring that praying man. So God's always contending for intimacy with us. It's never to control you. It's never to use you. Listen, he doesn't need you. He doesn't need me. If he uses me, that's just my privilege. Do you know why he would use me? For greater intimacy with him. That's why he's doing everything. Right? I mean, Jesus said, listen, you could turn these stones, you could turn these speakers into singers. You don't need me. You don't need the piano player. It's just my privilege that he uses me ever. And when he does, it creates greater intimacy. And that's always his objective. James chapter 4, verses 6 through 10 says this, but he gives us more grace. That's why scripture says God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. Notice, first of all, in this passage, how it begins and ends with humility. Look at this. He says in verse six, but he gives us more grace. This is why God says, God opposes the proud, but he shows favor to the humble. He shows favor to the humble. Then in the last verse, verse 10, it says this, humble yourselves, therefore, before the Lord, and he will lift you up. It's no coincidence that in talking about submission to God, which is what this is about, submitting yourself to God, that he begins with humility. An inability or an unwillingness to submit is most often a symptom of underlying arrogance. I feel like I should be in control. I feel like I should be making the calls. It's interesting. Arrogance makes intimacy with God impossible because the arrogant are the only people in Scripture that the Bible says God will resist. I mean, the scripture says, whosoever will, let him come unto the Lord, right? Whosoever will. But it says there is one kind of person that he will resist, the proud. God resists the proud. Even the proud who are sincere, they'll meet resistance from the Lord because he's not going to compete for control in your life. He's either Lord, or you can just hang out right where you are. He's in no hurry. He's got all of eternity to work with. He doesn't need a thing from you. So at some point, you'll just get miserable enough that you'll humble yourself, which is what James says is the beginning of this process. And then notice this sequence in Scripture. It's submit, resist, and come near. Can we look at this next series here, Josh? We've highlighted some different words in it this time. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Verse 8, come near to God and he will come near to you. So that's the sequence of events, right? We submit, we resist sin, and we come near to God. Without submission, without a submissive spirit, resistance to sin is almost impossible. And without resistance to sin, drawing near to him is almost impossible. So these things are connected. There is a direct connection between our ability to submit and our ability to experience intimacy with the Lord. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 5. Fascinating passage of scripture here regarding the Savior. Here's what it says. Every high priest is selected from among the people and is appointed to represent the people in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sin. He is able to deal gently with those who are ignorant and are going astray, since he himself is subject to weakness. This is why he has to offer sacrifices for his own sins as well as for the sins of the people. And no one takes this honor on himself, but he receives it when he is called by God, just as Aaron was. In the same way, Christ did not take on himself the glory of becoming a high priest, but God said to him, you are my son, and today I have become your father. And he says in another place, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries. and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard. Why? Because of his reverent submission. I mean, think of this for a second, guys. We're talking about Jesus Christ. That's who this is describing, the Son of God. Back up for a second, Josh. I mean, just process this for a moment. I don't know what you think of when you think of Jesus walking the earth. I don't know if it's like this sort of Barry Gibb looking guy, very gentle and laid back and with a British accent. But the Bible says that when Jesus prayed, he offered up petitions with fervent cries and tears. When Jesus left the disciples to go have his quiet time, they could hear what was going on. Listen, make no mistake, that's why they asked Jesus, teach us to pray. Whatever we learned in the temple, it's not what you're doing when you get alone with the Father. Something altogether different is happening when you pray. Do you picture that from Jesus bellowing, crying out to God, tears streaming down his face? I mean, that's who Jesus was. Tears to the one who could save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Let's keep going, verse 8. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. Son of God, though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. Listen, if Jesus, the Son of God, had to learn submission through suffering, do you think we get a pass on that? Verse 9. And once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. And he was designated by God to be a high priest in the order of Melchizedek. Melchizedek is an interesting biblical character, and this is a fascinating comparison here in Hebrews. Only place we hear of this, by the way. It's significant because priests were Levites, right? They were priests in the order of Aaron. Aaron was the high priest, and then all of his lineage became priests. You were born into the priesthood. You were a Levite. But Jesus was a high priest, though he was from Judah. He wasn't from Levi, right? He wasn't a Levite. He wasn't from the tribe of Levi. And to make this make sense, the writer of Hebrews calls on this really peculiar incident that happened in the life of Abraham. So Abraham, father of our faith, we really don't know a ton about where he came from. We know who his father was and who his grandfather was, but when we're introduced to Abram, which is his name initially in the Old Testament, we're just told that he's a guy that honored the Lord, and the Lord made a promise to him that he would make him a great nation. That was not the covenant yet. That was just a promise God made him. Hey, I'm going to give you lots of children. Abraham had a small army, and he had conquered a nation. And as he's coming back from that battle, he meets the king of Shalem. The king's name is Melchizedek. And the fascinating part about this, first of all, he meets him on a mountain that would become Jerusalem. That's how it actually got its name. He was the king of Shalem, which is Jerusalem. So Melchizedek was the king of Shalem, which his name is two Hebrew words that means the king of righteousness. And Shalem is a derivative of Shalom. So he's the king of righteousness living on a mountain of peace. That's who Melchizedek was. And the interesting thing is that Abraham encounters him and immediately identifies him, first of all, as a follower of Jehovah. Now, that's a shock, because it was just Abraham's family. So far as he knew, he and his family were the only ones who worshiped this invisible God. But as he's coming back from battle, he meets a man who worships the same God. And is not only that, but he identifies him as a priest of God. It's always a little shocking, isn't it? When you meet someone who doesn't look like you, think like you, talk like you, who still loves the Lord. It's always a bit of a revelation. So Abraham meets this priest, this man of authority. And the priest, because he sees Abraham as a brother in the Lord, feeds his entire army. And Abraham, in tribute, gives Melchizedek a tenth of everything he owns. Everything they had just gathered in battle, which was a lot. They had just had several huge victories, and he gives in tribute to him a tithe. It's the first tithe in Scripture, and it's the basis for all tithing from that point forward. He gives to Melchizedek a tithe. And because of Abraham's acknowledgement of Melchizedek as a spiritual authority and his reverent submission and his tithe to him, in the very next chapter, the Lord puts him into a deep sleep. And in that sleep, he divides the body of a bull, and a giant smoking pot moves in between, and he forms with Abraham a covenant, because he found in Abraham not just a man who loved him, but a man who understood spiritual authority. And so the writer of Hebrews says, listen, Jesus was not one of these flawed priests that came down from Aaron's line. He didn't come into this because he got born in the right family. He's a priest in the order of Melchizedek. He's outside the prescribed line, but he's a priest because the hand of God rests on him, because anointing rests on him, not because of who his daddy was or his granddaddy was. He's a priest because the hand of God rests on him. He's a priest in the order of Melchizedek. It's a whole different thing. And because of that, he says here, he was given double honor as a priest and the ability to pay for the sins of all mankind, not just one man's sin for one season. He was perfected. He learned submission through the things that he suffered. He was perfected, the scripture says, and he died and was designated a priest in the order of Melchizedek. Really, really powerful, really, really significant. Two things really significant revealed in this passage. First of all, Christ's prayers were heard because of his reverent submission, and he learned submission through the things that he suffered. Listen, the best way to foster intimacy with your children is the steady, consistent application of loving discipline. Strong, steady discipline. Weak-willed parents produce rebellious children. And it happens for all the right reasons. It happens because you love them and you're trying to compensate. That great prophet, Dr. Phil McGraw, says, he says, overindulgence is just another form of child abuse. And God is a good, good father. He is a good, good father. And he knows that a good father applies strong, steady discipline because you learn obedience through the things that you suffer. And obedience produces intimacy. Obedience, submission produces intimacy. I came across a fascinating video that addressed this point a few years ago. I wanted to show it to you. Check this out.
What we're doing here today is being able to show this little paint horse that you see running around behind us, that it can get two questions that it constantly asks answered. The two questions this horse is constantly asking is, where can it find comfort, and where does its leadership come from? So Abby Hornace is going to become the center of this project and will become the source of leadership and comfort for this horse. What we're doing with this mare is trying to teach this horse to find and seek comfort, that it can run around all over this arena and try to find the two things it's looking for. It's looking for leadership and it's looking for comfort. And what we're doing with this mare is teaching her how to find that leadership and comfort. We're telling her comfort is not over there, because if you go over there, I'm going to make you keep moving. If you go over there, I'm going to make you keep moving. And we're letting this horse find comfort and leadership in the form of Abby in the center of the arena. How long it takes this horse to find that comfort and leadership is entirely up to the horse. There is not comfort by this barrel. There is not comfort down on that end by Jackie. There is not comfort turning and looking toward me. Not there, not there. Let this horse find where comfort is, and let it seek and find its leadership and its comfort by finding Abby. And now the teachable moment is completed. No pressure is now being put on the horse. The two questions about where its leadership comes from and where its comfort is has been answered. And now wherever Abby goes, as long as she supplies the leadership with her body language and her demeanor, that horse is glad to follow, because it is the most comfortable thing that horse can be doing right now, is submitting to the leadership of Abby.
Isn't that something? Submission always, always produces intimacy. It always produces intimacy. I remember my daughter telling me one time after a particularly difficult thing, you know, where I'd had to apply some discipline. It was tough on her. Once it was all done, she came and snuggled up next to me and said, "You know, after you discipline me, I always feel so much closer to you." And it's true. It's true. I mean, we deprive our kids of that at their expense. We make ourselves feel better at their expense. I remember, you know, in the early days of becoming a dad and seeking the Lord and asking him, you know, with such a fractured image of what a dad is, I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do. And it was after going through some of this, and the Lord spoke to me and said, "You will teach your daughter loving discipline. Everyone else can teach her love. You will teach her discipline. You will teach her how to bow her head, how to receive correction. And that will produce intimacy." And when we learn that with the Lord, just like the picture of that horse, you know, he's very patient. He'll let us run around and run around and run around and get exhausted, then run around and run around, if we will just come to him. Here's the picture that the scripture draws for us in the book of Revelation. I'm going to close with this. This is the Lord speaking to the church. "Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person, and they with me." We think that this scripture is about the lost. That's what we teach it all the time, right? "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." Like God knocking at the door to your heart. You know, just let him in. Invite Jesus in. But this isn't for the lost. This is to the church. This was to the church at Laodicea. He's talking to people who love him and follow him but won't submit to him. And it's producing lukewarmness. It's producing a frustration where you're not getting the fruit that you want out of your spiritual life. You do want it, but wanting it isn't enough. And here's what he says. He says, "Listen, those whom I love, I rebuke and chasten. So be zealous and repent. Submit to my hand. Behold," he says, "I'm standing here knocking. I want greater intimacy with you. I want to be connected with you. And if you'll just open the door, I'll come in and we'll have fellowship. But if you insist on having your way, if you insist on it being on your terms, then you're just going to stand on the other side of that door, wishing you had something, but not being able to have it because you can't get the door open." The Lord never, first of all, he'll just never pry something from your hands. He just doesn't do that. And he'll never ask you to release something that you would be better off keeping. And I can't explain to you why it was in my mind that releasing this anger, this chip on my shoulder, what I thought it would cost me, I know that I hung on to it ferociously. I felt like I was entitled to it. It was kind of addictive in a way. And it was confusing. I'll tell you that. I mean, once I let it go, I wasn't sure how to feel or what to do or what's next. And I thought that what would happen was once I let it go, that there would be this miracle healing and reconciliation, and that didn't happen. It wasn't at all what I thought in my head. But I can tell you this, if I hadn't been willing, if Jack hadn't been at my door, if I hadn't spent the rest of that semester on that drain pipe deep in the woods, I wouldn't be here talking to you tonight, that's for sure. That's for absolute sure. Because God has placed authority figures in your life to provide for you a greater avenue of intimacy with himself. And I just want to say to you guys and to anyone who might see this online, I know what a hard swallow that is for some folks. I just want to tell you that you're talking to a guy who understands, and I sympathize. And if even hearing this makes you mad and you want to throw the monitor, or you want to come up on stage and punch me like I wanted to punch Josh McDowell, I hope I get to meet him one day and repent for wanting to punch him in his big fat face. Because his little visit to Buies Creek really changed everything. I mean, God could have gotten to me some other way, but boy, he really lit a fuse that day. And I'm just praying that this teaching will light a fuse for some of you, because it's huge. It's a game changer. And if you're one of these people that's gone through this study and this is just not an issue for you, God bless you, man. It must be nice. I know that there are folks that, you know, that you either had good parental role models or you just adjusted well, you adjusted differently, and this has not been an issue for you. Lord, we cast it out. Just kidding. So if that's you, praise God for that. I know that is the case. You know, I've met plenty of people for whom this wasn't an issue, but if it is, just know that I love you and I'm praying for you, and don't be reluctant to reach out if there's any way I can help. Let me pray and we'll close. Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the power of this, Lord. And Lord, I just want to restate, I just want to echo what you said in your word, that even now, in this moment, in the sanctity of this moment, you are standing at the door and knocking. And if anybody will open up, you will come in and you will commune with them and them with you. And I thank you, Lord, for the gentle persistence of your Holy Spirit in these issues. Prayerless in Christ's name. Amen. Thanks, everyone. Have a great night. See you next week.